Hi, good afternoon. As was mentioned before, my name is Austin Krause. I'm from the City University of New York, Macaulay Honors College, studying at the College of Staten Island. And I'm going to be talking to you about the extension of the fuzzy Gustafson-Kessel algorithm based on adaptive cluster merging. So, really quickly, what is clustering? Well, clustering is an unsupervised learning technique. By an unsupervised learning technique, it means that we're really not providing any information about the data set that's being provided. So we're throwing a data set at the algorithm and just seeing what picks up. It partitions the data set into several groups based on the similarity of the data values that are contained within that set. And the goal of it is to find the hidden structure within the data set, grouping data points based on the similar values. So, for example, how many clusters are up here? Well, we can say that there's two because we see that nice solid division down the middle. But now let's add another variable in. Now we say that we have two groups, one that's squares, one that's triangles. We've now even further created the fact that we have two groups. Now, change shape again because we're adding another variable in there. We can see that there's now four groups. You have those little blue triangles, you have those stars, you have the yellow stars, and you have the square yellow squares. Throw in another variable, because we're continuing to iterate through that data set, and we wind up with six clusters, because we now have the green triangles, the red stars, the blue circles, the golden stars, the golden diamonds, and the yellow squares. So, membership functions. Membership functions is how well it indicates the relationship between a data point and a data cluster. So, it ranges in value typically from 0 being no relationship to 1 being a full relationship. In traditional learning techniques or traditional truth values, you either have a solid 1 or a solid 0. It is or it isn't. With the introduction of fuzzy logic, we can now have partial truth values. So, for example, we can have a data point can be in 0.3% membership, 30% membership to cluster 1, 25% to cluster 2, and 45% to cluster 3. But therefore, since it has that highest value to cluster 3, it'll be most likely associated with cluster 3. So, real world example of that. When is the weekend start and end? Well, for me, weekend ends around Thursday when my class is let out. However, for some people that might be 5 o'clock on Friday when their work ends. So there's the two membership functions. So typical membership would be according to standard tradition Friday, 11:59:59, 12 o'clock hits on Saturday. We are now officially in the weekend because Saturday is considered a weekday. It'll then continue to 11:59 on Sunday, 11:59 on Sunday, midnight hits on Sunday/Monday, and it goes back down because Monday is now considered a weekday. However, with fuzzy logic, we can see on Thursday we're starting to get that increase in membership value. We're at peak value Friday and Saturday. Saturday starts to come because, you know, you're getting your stuff ready for Monday, you're getting, you know, looking at the agenda, and all that, and then we're slowly decreasing on the decline until Monday. So, the two algorithms that we use are fuzzy c-means, and it's a minimization of the function as shown above. And it's within that function, you have that exponent m, which is degree of fuzziness. The degree of fuzziness is how well or how fuzzy you want those values to get. So, it can range anywhere from 1 to infinity. However, as you start getting infinitely, it's like looking at a blurred picture. You still want to be able to make out what you are actually looking at. So we're going to keep it between 1 and 3, and the membership values are assigned in a spherical distribution, as shown above in the picture, regardless of the actual shape, which can be a problem because typically clusters are not oriented in those round circular patterns, they're typically spread out. And it also relies on classic Euclidean distances, which is that standard formula you've learned in school, square root y2 minus y1 squared plus x2 minus x1 squared. Really ineffective. So, we then have the Gustafson-Kessel method, which is a minimization of, it's a derivative of that same FCM function shown above. From there, it detects clusters of various different shapes and sizes using adaptive distance norms, which allows for different sizes. It associates each cluster with a matrix containing its cluster center and its covariance, and it's more computationally heavy than fuzzy CM because it's using those matrices and those Mahabharata-Nabi's distance. It accounts for the fact that there's different variances moving in different directions and the covariance of how well the different variables are moving in well to in changing to each other. Variables tend to show positive behavior, the covariance is positive. If the variables are showing opposite relationships, negative. Okay, so validation measures. So when we're coming in there, we have somewhat of a good idea of what we're doing, but we really are unsure. So that's where we run the validation measures. The validation measures ensure that the number of clusters we're coming up with are in fact correct and it's not some extreme value. So the number of clusters K is considered optimal where the partition coefficient is at a local maximum with a maximum value of 1. And the partition coefficient is determined using the formula above, where I is a cluster set and B is a data point with membership to cluster I. So, what did we actually do here? Well, the modification of the algorithm, the parameters for the fuzzy GK algorithm are pre-processed using ISO data. ISO data is a hard clustering algorithm and it relies on those basic truth values of 1 or 0. So when that's first run, it gives us a decent idea of what we're actually going on. Okay, again, it's less computationally heavy than running fuzzy GK over and over again. So from there, the number of clusters from ISO data is iterated over for K plus or minus 3. And then we run those that partition coefficient. That tells us, you know, gives us a good idea, plus or minus 3, are we in the right direction? And based on where that local maximum is within that plus or minus 3 is the cluster, the value of K that we continue with. Once the optimal clusters have been determined using the partition coefficient, the distance between all cluster centers are determined, and then the average distance and the standard deviation are calculated, and that's where we go from there. So once the minimum distance of all the cluster centers is found, if that is less than 1 minus standard deviation from the mean, it means they're really, really close together. If they're really, really close together, it probably means they should be merged into one group. And this is an illustration above of the actual algorithm itself. So for example, if that's our distance matrix, and what we did is we calculated the distance, so if we're going 4x4, where 1, 2, 3, 4 is cluster 1, 2, 3, 4, and going down is cluster 1, 2, 3, 4. So for example, okay, this should be cluster 1 to cluster 1, distance between 1 to 2, 1 to 3, 1 to 4, 2 to 1, 2 to 2, so on and so forth. So based on that, once we have that matrix calculated, we then take the average distance. In this case, the average distance was 146 with a standard deviation of 65. So minus 1 standard deviation from that would be 81, and the minimum distance in this case is 73. So once we figured out that 73 was below that threshold of minus 1 standard deviation, we come over here and clusters 3 and 4 will be merged. As shown there. And it does make sense because if you think about it, we are expecting that triangle there. Okay, and there's our experiment number one. Experiment number one is a two-dimensional data set with 3,000 data points. The data set is that in the shape of a large triangle enclosed on three sides by three square blocks. The expected number of clusters is 4, one for the giant triangle in the middle, and one for each three enclosing bars. And the partition coefficient, as you spoke about earlier, does validate that we do have 4 clusters with that local maximum at 0.711. And here's our expected results. Because this was a generated data set and we had an idea of what we were actually expecting, we can use that confusion matrix to validate it. So along the diagonal are the ones that were accurately matched with their cluster center. So in that matrix C1, 69.12% using the original GK algorithm were accurately matched. In the second matrix, that was our modification, and in our modification, we can see that 81.29% were merged. That's a 15.74% increase, which is fantastic. And then there's the side-by-side. We can see the original clusters 3 and 4, which were merged, and our original expectation of clusters 1, 2, and 4. Now, again, since we did verify that the partition coefficient should have been, the partition coefficient did state that we should have 4 clusters, but we did wind up with 3, that is okay because we did have that greater accuracy. So we're sacrificing the number of clusters generated for that generated accuracy. So now, here comes the real world example. Real world example is two-dimensional data set with 753 data points. These data points were generated from GPS locations from the social media network Twitter. So we were able to go back, scrape the tweets from the API, and able to throw them in there. And they were generated from Six Flags Great Adventure in Jacksonville, New Jersey. Now, based on our knowledge of the area, we know that there's the park, the Central Park, and two housing complexes on either side. However, the two housing complexes on either side typically should not be tweeting about Six Flags. They're probably tweeting about, you know, whatever's randomly going on in their lives. So we want to exclude those out, but we do want to account, we want to analyze the actual tweets that are coming from Six Flags. So, based on our knowledge and the use of a geographical information system, we were able to realize that clusters 3 and 4 were merged, resulting in three clusters. The clusters for Hurricane Harbor and Six Flags Great Adventure, which were the two primary parks, were merged into one, which is perfectly acceptable, as it's what we were expecting. And one cluster for each housing development on either side of the amusement park were left in place. In conclusion, based on our results, we can conclude that our modification of the FGK algorithm can be implemented for high-scale dimensional real-world data sets. So for example, we can throw as many as n variables against this algorithm and still get these expected results. Research can be extended into the fields of data mining and large-scale data analytics of social media. Again, it can also be implemented in some cases like fraud prevention. So for example, when your credit card is coming out and they're looking, oh, Johnny's making purchases, you know, 20 miles from his house at 1 o'clock in the morning for $200. And typically most purchases that he's making are, you know, half a mile away from his house at 1 o'clock in the afternoon at $5. We can then flag that out because that's going to be an extreme on the cluster and we can pull that out. Future research is going to be done to investigate more extensive and expensive validation measures and to incorporate density functions for more accurate cluster merging. Okay, and any questions? Sure.
Can you use this technique of cluster merging to say like reduce the degrees of freedom if you're trying to optimize a system and you say like don't really know where to start?
Sure, it could be because again you're throwing all those different values at it and trying to pull that. However, it is going to work when you have greater density. If you have four or five different values, for example, so if you're throwing that at a system and you only have four to five data points to cluster, because again, you're not generating 200-300 systems, you're generating 5 or 6. You're really not going to get that out of this algorithm because it's not really made to deal with, you know, with few data values. It's meant to deal with, you know, a few hundred or a few thousand where it wouldn't be easily able to partition with the human eye. Any other questions? All right. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. I'm Karia Divert. I'm a sophomore math major here at MIT. And I'm going to be talking about something I did over the summer with Hayden Jansen and Jeremy Kepner at MIT's Lincoln Laboratory. This is just an overview of how this is going to go. I'm going to start out with the motivation behind the problem. Then, because it's kind of a mathy problem, I'm going to go over some definitions of some of the graph theory concepts and associative array concepts. These definitions will help us set up the problem statement. Then we'll discuss the solution of the problem statement, get a little bit into the proof of the solution, then just talk about the results and go over a few examples. Let's get started on the motivation. So big data, or just data in general, is processed in a lot of different ways. That's used to do a lot of different things, but at different points in the processing system, it's viewed from different perspectives, or it's viewed in different forms. So some of the common forms are spreadsheets, database tables, matrices, and graphs. And luckily, all these four types have the same sort of mathematical structure, and it's that structure that we're describing with associative arrays. And we'll define associative arrays a bit better in the next section. Now, one thing we often want to do is translate data from a graph format or spreadsheet format into, spreadsheet or matrix format into a graph. And the operation that we used to do that with associative arrays is that operation you see there, that A equals ET out, E in. And I'll talk about that one a lot more in the next section. But the main idea of this project is, when is that statement actually true? When can we generate the graphs this way? So I'm going to get into some definitions now. An associative array, you can think of just like a matrix, except that the rows and columns are labeled, and then the labels are ordered. And we call these ordered sets of labels key sets. And the definition of an associative array that we're using here is that it's a map from the key sets to a value set. The value set is just the stuff that can be in the array. And one thing it's really important to realize is that the values in the value set don't have to be numbers. They could be, for example, words with a lexicographical ordering. And now these are some graph theory definitions. Defining instance arrays a bit differently than you might normally see them. We're defining them in pairs, so we have E out and E in. And the way this works is that if there's a, you can see there's a symbol in row one, column A for E out, that means that edge one is going out of A. And you can see in E in, we've got symbols in row one, columns B and C, meaning edge one is going into B and C. So edge one goes out of A into B and C, and then you can see the same thing for edge two, goes out of C and into B. And that's how those work. And adjacency arrays, you might already be familiar with. Those are just arrays relating the nodes to each other. So a symbol in row A, column B means there's an edge directed from A to B. And both those arrays there are for that graph. So now this statement here that you saw like two or three slides ago, the actual meaning of that statement is that A, our adjacency array, is equal to E out transpose array multiplied with E in. And so the question we're asking is, for which graphs is this true? Real quick on array multiplication. It's just like matrix multiplication, except you have to watch out for the labels. So you gotta match the column labels of the first one with the row labels of the second one. And then you dot product just the way you would normally do with your A through H in the value set. And so the difference that we're doing here is normally you just use regular addition and multiplication. But what we did is we generalized addition and multiplication to any binary operation, for example, maximum and minimum. And so what we were asking is which set and operations let us do this multiplication and get an adjacency array. Now there's a formal problem statement that's basically just saying the same thing I just said. It's saying for which graphs whose weights are in a value set can, and which operations that we're using on that value set, can we multiply the instance arrays to get an adjacency array. And then basically what we did to solve this is we came up with the conditions and proved that they're necessary and sufficient. So these are the conditions that we came up with. The first one is that there's no additive inverses, or that nothing non-zero, so no non-trivial additive inverses, nothing non-zero can add to zero. The second is that nothing non-zero can multiply to zero. And then finally, we want zero to annihilate the value set, meaning anything times zero equals zero times anything equals zero. And then this is sort of how we did the necessity proof. We did it by contradiction for each condition. So we first assumed the problem statement, and then we assumed in turn the opposite of each condition, and we found a graph for which that A equals E out transpose times E in thing is violated. So for the first condition, the no additive inverse condition, that's one of the many graphs that would violate the problem statement. So we did that for each of the three conditions, and that gave us necessity. And then for the sufficiency, proof was pretty easy actually. We just assumed the conditions and then with a lot of manipulation, the if and the only if direction of the problem statement followed. So that was a lot better. And then a corollary that was kind of interesting, I guess, popped out, which was that if you switch out and in, so you E in transpose E out instead of E out transpose E in, we get the adjacency array of the reverse graph. So now I'm just going to go over the results and a couple examples. So it's useful to know which structures satisfy the conditions that we came up with. And the big one that satisfies them is semirings. There's a definition down there of semirings, just like for information. And the other things that satisfy them are, they would be semirings, except they're missing some property. So we call that a semiring structure. So like it would be a semiring, except addition isn't commutative or something like that. But a big important point is that rings do not satisfy. And the reason they don't is because they have additive inverses, and that violates the first condition. So rings don't work, but semi-rings do. Here's a quick example of this in action. Maybe we could say these are shipments or something. And we want to know who sent how much to whom. And we can figure this out using something called plus-min algebra. So our binary operations, addition is just addition as it normally is. Sorry. And multiplication is taking the minimum. So for example, in this case, 5 plus 3 would still be 8, but 5 times 3 would be 3, because it's a minimum. And yeah, we can check that all the conditions are satisfied by this algebra. So that means that given the instance arrays, we can multiply them and get that adjacency array. And keep in mind that we're not assuming you already have the graph, we're assuming you just got these instance arrays maybe from a database or spreadsheet. And yeah, you can see that the adjacency array works out. You know, A did send like 8 things to C and so on. So let's try one more example. This one's different. It's a bipartite undirected graph. Bipartite just means that there's two sets. Undirected just means there's no direction. So when an undirected graph, there's no out and in. So E out equals E in. And I'm going to see here that the values are the number of times a word occurs in the document. And so maybe we want to know the number of times these words occur in pairs. So like if you had a document with two words that occurred a lot, that pair of words would have a really high score, for example. And we can actually use the same plus min algebra that we used before. We multiply E transpose E, and we get this. And I've just bolded, the numbers that are bolded just are there because they're large numbers. And so clearly the diagonal is going to be pretty large, because it's just the number of times the word occurred. But some of these other word pairs, you can see abelian and group are used together a lot. And we can actually construct the graph that relates these words to each other using this. And that's this. And so the bold lines here correspond again with the bold symbols, the bold numbers in the previous array. And so you can see like two topics of conversation sort of emerge. Like there's the ring of power thing and then the math topic. Right, so we determine the conditions so that you can multiply instance arrays and get adjacency arrays. And we identify the structures, the algebraic structures that comply with these conditions. And one thing that I thought was kind of interesting to look into is that the conditions, while they do ensure that the adjacency array is correct, they don't ensure that all the matrix transpose properties hold for the adjacency array or for the instance arrays. And so it might be kind of interesting to sort of find out more about what conditions we would need to add if we wanted to use those things. So then behind me is just sort of an overview of everything I said, and I can take questions now if there are any.
Hi, my name is Leonidas Tolais. I'm a senior in the Electrical Engineering Department at Princeton University, and today I'm going to be talking to you guys about some photonics work that I've been working on. So my work is centered around building artificial neural networks. Artificial neural networks are a pretty common topic in machine learning nowadays. They're very good at solving control problems and predicting outcomes based on some input data. And the problem with artificial neural networks is that they are analog systems, and the brunt of our computational abilities right now are digital. Digital systems are very bad at emulating analog systems. They're very slow at it, they don't do it very efficiently. So the solution to this is either build much faster computers, which is hard, or build some other hardware that is analog that can recreate the behaviors of a real neural network. So a lot of people have tried to do this using electronics, microelectronics, and the problem that you run into with microelectronics for these sort of networks is that in a fully recurrent neural network, you need to be able to have each neuron in the network connect to every other neuron in the network. This means that you need n squared connections, if n is the number of neurons, in order to set up a good neural network. This is very difficult to do with electronics as you scale your networks past the 1,000, 100,000, million neuron points. And this is because this all has to happen physically on a chip. You have to have wires coming into a particular neuron element. And anytime you put a lot of wires very close together on a chip, you get capacitances between them, you run into bandwidth problems, and it puts a pretty harsh limitation on how fast you can have your neural network process stuff if you want it to be a large neural network. Now, photonics are a system by which we can get around this because they are much faster, they scale better, and they have a lot higher bandwidth than electronics do. This is largely due to the fact that whereas with electronics, each signal coming from another neuron needed to occupy a different wire on a chip, with photonics, you can use techniques such as wavelength division multiplexing, which is a very common technique used in the telecommunications industry to put lots of signals on a single channel, to connect all the neurons with just one waveguide or fiber optic cable that can broadcast many different frequencies around between the neurons, and each frequency in the fiber effectively acts as one connection from a neuron to another. So the way wavelength division multiplexing works basically is that each different channel that you want to send on the fiber, you send on a slightly different wavelength, and since electric and magnetic fields just sum in dielectric media, you can just send as many different wavelengths as you want down a fiber, and then on the other end have some sort of filter where you filter out one wavelength of light at a time, and then you separate your channels out there. So that's a bit about why photonic neural networks are a good thing to look at. Now on to how do you recreate the physics of a neuron? So the base unit of a neuron is something that I'm going to refer to as a spike processor. It operates not on continuous inputs, but on an interesting hybrid analog digital system where the heights of each spike are the same. This is somewhat digital, and the information is encoded in the amount of time between subsequent spikes. That's obviously an analog variable. This leads to a completely analog system. Basically what a neuron does is it receives a lot of spikes. It sums them all together, as you can see in the diagram up on top. It integrates this over time so that spikes that arrive slightly out of sync, these are asynchronous, there's no clock or anything. So spikes that arrive slightly out of time can still add up since there's a small amount of integration. And then there's a final nonlinear thresholding step where basically this is this decision-making process of the neuron. If your gain or your carrier concentration in terms of photonics rises above a certain point, then the neuron will fire an output spike. And below the diagram, you can see basically the same process in a differential equation, which is how you would normally simulate one of these. Okay, so our platform for designing a artificial neuron, or an artificial spike processor, as we'll call it, out of photonic components, yeah, at the fiber scale is displayed up here. Basically, this consists of erbium doped fiber, the UDF in orange at the top, which provides the gain and integration of the neuron, a graphene saturated absorber, the GSA on the bottom, which provides the thresholding and pulse generation characteristics of the neuron, and then a couple of other device, optoelectronic and optical devices that just let us kind of control. I have a polarization controller that makes sure that the polarization stays the same on each round trip of the fiber loop. You have an isolator, which just ensures one direction of propagation inside the loop. And basically what this is a pretty classical Fabry-Perot laser with a saturable absorber thrown in the middle. A Fabry-Perot laser is just the basic way that we design lasers, which is you take a cavity, you put a mirror on either end, you have a gain medium inside it, and as light back bounces back and forth, you end up with lasing. So a little more in depth about why graphene for thresholding, and then we'll get to why erbium dope fiber for gain integration. So graphene has the convenient property of being a saturable absorber in the optical domain. This means that as you continue to put optical power onto graphene, it will continue to absorb, and then eventually when you reach some threshold, it will just let all the light through. This is very similar to how a neuron will not fire as the gain increases, and then eventually just let out one spike at the end. The erbium dope fiber to provide gain, we use due to the band structure in erbium dope fiber. And this band structure allows us to maintain a carrier concentration by pumping it with 980 nanometer light, then excite and then cause rapid transitions using 1480 nanometer light in order to create inputs to our neuron. And I can get into more of how this works if people have questions. Okay, so once we developed the platform, the first step was to figure out, let's put some test inputs, does this act the way you would expect a neuron to act? So a basic test for a neuron is, does it integrate and does it threshold? So on the left here, we see a simple test where we put a big input spike to the neuron, we don't get an output spike. We put a small input spike to the neuron, we still don't get an output spike. But we send 5 of the small input spikes in a row, and you can see that the carrier concentration, or the gain in the cavity, which is reflected in the output, rises slowly until you get to a point where it exceeds the threshold of the neuron and you fire an output spike. Likewise, another good test for neuron behavior is testing the ability of a neuron to convert pulse widths into alternating numbers of spikes. So up here on the right, you see that if we put a 1 delta T pulse in, we get 1 spike out, a 2 delta T pulse gives us 2 spikes, 3 delta T pulse gives us 3 spikes out. So now that we've verified that the neuron actually works as expected, the final step is to determine whether or not this will be useful in the real world. So in general, we want to be able to take real-world data, which is analog, and input it to a neuron, have the neuron convert it to a spike train representation, after which we can send it to the rest of the network and have processing happen. So I used a 10 millisecond clip of a Led Zeppelin song as my analog input, and you can see here at 2 different time scales what happens when you input this into the neuron. On the left here, this is a zoomed in time scale. And you can see that the neuron pretty accurately manages to convert the analog input into a spike train output. You can kind of see that the differences in time between spikes in places where there's thicker analog input kind of indicates the amount of the analog value of the input at that time. And zooming out a little bit and looking at 2 periods of our input, you can see that the neuron is behaving in a memoryless configuration, which is what we want. They're not supposed to be affected over time by previous inputs outside of the integration time, the relatively short integration time that they have. So basically, with this, we now know that we can create a photonic neural network that can take analog inputs and process them in real time. Now, you can see that the time scales in all these experiments are relatively long, which begs the question, I made the claim at the beginning of the presentation that these are much faster than microelectronics at doing this. The reason these are so long is because this setup, this experimental platform that we did these tests on, is a huge loop of fiber optic cable sitting on a lab table. This means that the carrier lifetime in this fiber loop is very long, just due to its large physical size. And this is what leads our neuron to be so slow in this case. However, what I'm working on now, and the solution for this, is to create these same neurons out of integrated photonics rather than a fiber system. So rather than a long fiber optic cable on a table, waveguides on a chip. Small, on the order of a couple of hundred microns, resonators on a chip with symmetrical absorbers and a gain. And this is very doable. Like, you can build these, and hopefully next time I will be presenting that.
Hi everybody, my name is Matthew Sheehan.
I'm Omar Abus.
We're both from Wentworth Institute of Technology. We're going to be showing our senior design project. We recently graduated in August, but we did most of this while we were undergrads. It's called U-Vision. As you'll learn more, it's a little bit of a clever name. And let's get right into it.
Alright, so the problem. The problem we're trying to address is skin cancer. Right now there's 5 million US cases of skin cancer each year, costing about $8.3 billion to the healthcare industry. And that just means 1 in 5 people at some point in their life will get skin cancer. So this is the problem we tried to tackle. We tried to tackle it from an awareness perspective to prevent it almost indirectly. The objectives, we wanted to monitor sun exposure and warn when exposure is exceeding healthy levels. We want to do this by creating a mobile app and pairing it with a UV sensor, a wearable UV sensor. So it's split up into the mobile app and the sensor, so I'll go into the sensor aspect. So the goals of the sensor, first of all, it has to be portable and lightweight, so you can bring it anywhere. It has to be easily rechargeable, because you don't want to have to switch out batteries every time. Waterproof, because ideally people will probably bring this to the beach or a pool. And it should be standalone. Even though it's going to pair with the app, it should still be able to give you warnings on its own. The initial phasing was very large. We used Arduino Uno with a bunch of different sensors just to try it out. And we eventually switched to the much smaller electronics. Obviously, you can see compared to the size of the quarter, it's very small. Right there, we have the Flora SI1145 sensor from Adafruit. We found that to be the best one. We tried out several different sensors, but that was definitely the best one. Arduino Mini, the Bluetooth module, and a lithium polymer battery. The casing design was designed through SolidWorks. I'll go into more of this in the next slides. So first of all, I'll go into the wearable aspect. We just decided to go with a simple clip because we figured you can clip it onto anything. This is my sister demonstrating how you can wear it. She has it strapped onto a purse, different hats, even like a wristband or something. Just anything. We just wanted it to be very easy for someone to wear it without having to lose anything like a pin or a magnet. The battery, like I said, was a 3.7 volt lithium polymer battery. Battery life wasn't great. It's under 4 hours. But it's easily rechargeable with any USB cable. You can see the green PCB board I designed through Eagle. This would have decreased the size immensely, but due to soldering issues, we couldn't implement this. We had to use the Adafruit charging port. So this is the sensor. It's pretty bulky. We can easily get this a lot smaller just from decreasing the size of the charger. Waterproofing, through the prototyping phase, we figured out that plexiglass can be used to cover the sensor without hindering index that it receives. It actually made it more accurate because the sensor would read one UV index higher than what the actual weather station would read, and the plexiglass reduced that by an average of one. So it was actually very helpful, and this allows us to completely seal the sensor, so then we can make it waterproof in the future. Right now, it wasn't tested much. It was only tested for about a foot of water, depth of water. So that worked, and the casing design was also designed so that it encapsulates everything. So waterproofing is definitely more of a future thing. The program, once you turn it on, it is a calibration system where you just point it at the sun, and it'll give you the maximum index at that point. And then for the rest of the time, we have it right now set to average 10 in an array, but ideally you can probably do once every minute or even 10 minutes. UV index doesn't change that often. And there's an LED warning system on it, so it just makes it a standalone sensor. 0 to 5 is very minimal, so it'll turn on one LED in the front, and then 2 and so forth. So this gives you warnings of the UV index and if it's safe or not. Future direction, obviously decrease the size, which can be done easily in the future with just combining them into one PCB board. Longer battery life, we experimented with the Arduino sleep mode, which would allow us to turn it off at certain, if you're in shade, it would turn off rather than continuing to calculate. Better casing, right now it's 3D printed, which is not ideal for waterproofing, but that's all we could work with. And it's also very expensive to continually 3D print. And a custom clip design right now, this clip is not ideal, but it gets the job done, so. And then we'll go into the mobile aspect. Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I'm going to talk mainly about the application design setup. Essentially, we did this for Android. I'm not really familiar. I'm going to be honest, like when we started with this project, I had never done real programming like this before. We had never made an app or anything. So this was completely new, and so we decided to go with Android at first just to kind of make things a little easier on the learning curve part. And we thought about what would be like core features for something like this, and like a lot of times you could look at something like maybe Fitbit, you could look at, if you have an Android phone, a lot of you will have Google Fit built right in, and we were looking at like these health-based apps and think about like what are core features that you'd want if you were going to think about skin protection in application. And so we were thinking Bluetooth data connection, and some type of interface that feels nice, interactive, something that responds, and then we'd want personalization, because that's what a lot of people care about when it comes to their health. So this is the basic layout of the homepage. I'll be honest, I'm not like a user interface designer, so it's not perfect, but it is very simple and gets to what we wanted. It has the like basic UV index number. That's key to understand the UV index. And if you're not familiar, we want to have other pages that would tell you like what these things mean. And then we have like more of a colorful graph there that would have a bar. It's basically like a it's a bar that would fill up based on what the UV index is, what that means. And then we also want to make something that looks like an avatar that would kind of be a little bit of like a personalization feature, and that could illustrate what type of protection you should be wearing on that day given the UV index, and then have an SPF that would change based on the index as well. And this is a basic navigation drawer that you would input in the app, where you'd have these topics that you could look on, you could click on them, you'd be able to go into more information that would explain things for you if you were curious, you know. And navigation drawers is useful to help you direct through an app and navigate the app. And these are the content pages. Obviously, still not perfectly designed and not incredibly interesting, but we wanted to get to basic information, details that matter, and we thought that these were very helpful and kind of simple information, because not a lot of people do understand everything about the UV index. It's not something that you're necessarily like taught about a lot, but it's incredibly important if you want to understand like how strong the sun is on a given day, and if you should be applying protection. And there's other stuff like skin tone, what your skin tone means and how that affects whether you get sunburns or not. And so we want to include that information into the app to make it easy to access and understand. And this is just something more to like what's going on inside the app. So we had two things, basically async task, that's an Android kind of class. And then we had the Android Lite, and that was the database inside the phone. And so you'd basically have the data streaming in from the sensor to a database, And then from the database, the async task would take that data and update the UI directly. And that was basically what was going on inside, behind the scenes of the app. And so obviously, we had like an evolution of the interface. It doesn't look like it changes that much, but for our purposes, we felt like it was changing a lot because of how difficult it can be to set up an interface when you're new to like XML and you're new to these things, and you're new to programming these features. If one thing, I would have loved to have a circular bar instead of the rectangle one. The circular one would have been like really cool. But we had to settle for this rectangular one to keep things simple and work. And yeah, so that's how we comment. And we used to have just the images of protection, and then we wanted to go to an avatar to make it more personal. And like I said, if we were going to go further with this, we definitely want to add more personalization, a better forecast feature so you could forecast the weather for yourself, kind of like any other weather app, but sometimes you want to have more of your apps consolidate. And then improve the data features so you could better understand what the UV index is like over time and see, you know, if you have a pattern, if you're working, say you have a construction job, maybe you're traveling, you're doing something like that. You want to understand your environment and how it could be affecting your health, and you could do stuff like that. And just look and feel stuff. There's always times when you use an app and you'd love to improve how it feels, and that's something we always want to look into. And we want to give a special thanks to Professor Jones from Wentworth, who really helped us out with this project. He really got us into this, and he guided us through most of it, because we're biomedical engineers. We don't know much about programming at first, but he really helped us. And then a good student from Wentworth, Tyler Gouch, he really helped us with Bluetooth, because it was a really big hump to get over, and we finally were able to get through it. And, you know, what we wanted to bring here was basically that you could take UV radiation, which is kind of like this weird thing to think about in terms of health, but we want to bring it to more of a mobile aspect and think about how to use modern technology to increase awareness, kind of like how Fitbit has tried to make health and running more interactive. We want to bring other parts of health to be more interactive as well. Any questions?
Hi everyone, my name is Nick Bonzani. I did this project with a partner, his name was Ed. He's working in Cambodia, so he couldn't be here today. And I also have my advisors, Professor Yoon and Professor Jones up there, who definitely helped me a lot with this presentation and this project. So just a quick introduction about what the project is. It's basically an Android application similar to the last presentation, which could be used in a small scale, like a GPS application, but without the actual GPS functionality. And the reason we needed it is because I was at Northeastern University. I'm a student at Wentworth. I was next door at Northeastern. We were in the tunnels underneath the school, and I didn't know where I was. I was completely lost, and there's no GPS signal down there. So we had formulated a solution to this in that using NFC allows for very precise, as long as the application knows where the NFC tags are. It creates a very precise and user-friendly way to create a navigation system. So continuing on that, why did we choose NFC technology? As I said, NFC over GPS, because there's a lot of places that on campuses or elsewhere that GPS signal is not available. For whatever reason, you're underground, there's just no GPS signal there, whatever it is. So the NFC kind of bridges the gap between that. One of the things we had looked into was RFID. RFID wasn't useful for that because RFID requires about a 3-meter distance from the tag in order to tag the tag. Whereas NFC requires about a 4-centimeter distance, and it's a lot more precise if you're using NFC versus RFID. Plus NFC tags, the little things that you would tap with your phone, are a lot cheaper and more consumer friendly than any RFID tag. And so for a consumer that was building this, like a school for example, it would be a lot more cost effective for them to go with an NFC system. And as I mentioned, it was an Android application that we had built. We did this entire project in about the course of a month. I had no previous Android development experience, so a lot of this month was for a crash course in Android development. It was pretty tricky, but got through it. Some of the problems that we had with it, though, writing custom data to a tag was really interesting. I had never seen how to do that. There was very few resources online about that. We kind of had to go about it on our own. We figured it out. It was tricky, but it was definitely a really interesting part of the project. And some of the secondary problems that go along with that, writing the custom data to the tag was one thing, but detecting that custom data was an entirely different problem. And distinguishing between different tags required something that I had no idea how to do either. So the solution to that, just a quick picture of the code. This is the XML document, which is very blurry up there, but it creates using the mime type, which is a part of the NFC tag that you would write to the tag when you're creating the tags. It uses those to determine which tag it is and tells the application what information is on that tag. Just a few images about the application. This would be the home screen. That would be the activity telling you, you know, tag a tag. We'll go take it from there. When we had presented this project in our class, we had constructed a small maze out of styrofoam as a proof of concept. You'd tag a tag and it would tell you the best way to get out of the maze from that tag. And that was basically the basic map screen that we would use. It would say you're at the beginning of the map. At the maze, we had an NFC tag at the beginning of the maze, which is, it would show you that when you tagged that one. So some more on that. For example, where that dot is on point A is where the NFC tag was. When you tagged that, it would outline the best direction to the exit. The same one at point B. And then because ours was a maze, we had a small congratulations, you win the maze when you finished with it. So really the interesting part of the presentation is how to expand that. So like I said, originally we were planning on using this and implementing it as a campus-wide navigation system. Our school, Wentworth, also has underground tunnels and some very confusing connected buildings. By maybe someone who had never been to the campus before, could download this application before they come. It would have the information on the maps and everything in it, and they could tag a tag wherever they see one. It would have a sign maybe with a tag on it, and it would tell them, you know, where you are on the campus with a map, picture of the map. And it would tell them, you know, you tell them the application, I want to get to this place. It would tell you the best way to get there. All this information and all these calculations would be done in the app because you don't have any internet or GPS signal was the idea. Like I said, we only had a month to do this, so we didn't actually manage to implement that into the application, but that was the original goal. Something else we discovered while we were going through this is this application, the one that we had built, was really good for students who had never done Android development. It was a really good learning experience for us, and part of our project was, and part of the paper that we had submitted, was how good of a, like I said, a learning experience and how good of a resource this project could be for students who had never done Android development and wanted to learn how to incorporate NFC into their projects. Just a couple references there. Any questions? Pretty quick.
Hi everyone, I'm Samantha Miller. I'm a senior at St. Joseph's College in Patchogue, Long Island, in New York. So over the summer, I did an internship at the Brookhaven National Laboratory called the SULI program, which is Science Undergraduate Laboratory Internships. And while I was there, I was working with Dr. Lisa Miller. We're not related, but everyone always asks that because we have the same last name. But we did a project, and I'll explain. Okay. So I was working at the NSLS-2, which is the brand new light synchrotron there. It stands for National Synchrotron Light Source 2, and it's the second one that's been at the Brookhaven National Lab. The first one is actually decommissioned now, but since they had that first one, they were able to make this new NSLS-2 10,000 times brighter than the first one. And the first light was on October 23rd, 2014, so it was about a year ago. It's very expensive. It was $912 million to design and build the whole thing. It's like amazing on the inside. It's about the size of Yankee Stadium. It's a huge circular building. And it's actually not even fully completed yet, but it's working enough that people can do projects and research there. So on the next slide, I have an image of like what it would look like if you could take the roof off and see what it actually looks like underneath. So basically the way it works is in the top corner you see the ring. Basically electrons are shot through an electron gun into this booster ring, and they stay in there for about 1 second, and they're accelerated to 99.9% the speed of light. And then from there, they're released into the big ring, and when they're spinning in there, they're able to be released on these beam lines, which are all of the lines that run as a tangent to the circle. And when they are released through there, it's photons in the form of X-rays. So the way that would work is a scientist or, you know, a researcher would be at the end of each one of these beam lines. There's, I think, 64 planned to be built. Right now there's only 7 that are working. So the scientists, they're in hutches at the end of each of these beam lines. And you put a sample at the end of the beam line, and it gets shot with an X-ray, and then you can see a lot of information about it. So when I was working there, I was in LV3, which is on the bottom corner, and I was working a lot with SRX and HXN beam lines. So that's pretty much how it works. And so at the NSLS-2, there's a variety of synchrotron imaging techniques that provide users with chemical and physical properties of materials at the nanoscale. So that means that there's a lot of different options when it comes to ways that you can image a sample. So when you're working with the synchrotron, that's X-ray fluorescent microscopy. And then if you look at something with like a microscope, that's just visible light microscopy. And then there's also infrared. So these are all different examples of that. And if you look, the visible light, X-ray, and infrared, they all give you different information about the same sample. So that presents a problem when it comes to trying to correlate all of the information that you're getting, to try to see corresponding features on the same sample and see the different information that you're getting out of it. So, you know, there are different sizes and different spatial resolutions. So my project, the goals would be to find a way to use landmark points or fiducials on images that you can find on each one that would help you to align them, that correspond to each other. Like in this example, the eye, the beak, and then, you know, that could be stacked on top of each other. So then the motivation and goals of the project, there's a lot of different options of ways that you could go about doing this. So originally I was going to use Python and just write a program from scratch to do this, or MATLAB. But then we have ImageJ, which is open source Java image programming software, and Fiji, which is a plugin of ImageJ. And so Fiji is an extension of ImageJ. It's the most accurate and efficient method that we were researching and looking into. It's quicker than starting from scratch, and this is the next slide. This is an example of how it could be used. Like, the same algorithms in ImageJ are used in a lot of medical software to correlate images in MRI scans and CT scans. Can anyone tell what these are pictures of, what they're scans of?
Art.
It's fruit. Can you tell what
broccoli?
Yeah. That one's broccoli. That top one is a pineapple. That's a tomato, and those are strawberries. I just thought it was interesting. So the way it works is with a lot of linear algebra, because of the fiducial markers or landmark points that are on each image to try to correlate that. And each point is represented as a vector in a column of a matrix. And the method of least squares in matrix form can be used to find the rotation and translation needed to register the image. So a lot of different images, when you're looking at them on different imaging techniques, maybe it'll be rotated or it'll be zoomed in more, bigger, smaller. This is how it would find out what it has to do to correlate the images. So this is actually a picture from inside the lab of the light microscope that I was using. So obviously this would be visible light wavelength. And to simulate different wavelengths, I did different types of bright field, dark field, and fluorescent. So I focused mainly on visible light to get started with this. And it's all pictures of the same sample. So if I go back here, like this is all the same plant root sample, but you see it in a lot of different ways here. So the first image registration technique that I found out was landmarks, where the user basically would click on the same points in each image. So to show an example of this is the same plant root. This one's at 5x magnification, and this is at 50x on the microscope, so if you change the objective. And so this would be three points that you could see on the more zoomed in one. And then on the zoomed out, you pick the same three points. And in this example, the image was flipped over and rotated slightly, and of course, zoomed out a lot. So after clicking on these points, it aligns it in the same order. So the first point that you click on matches the one that was on the other image. And it crops it, zooms, and rotated it so that it aligns to match. And this has a lot of room for error because it goes off of what a person clicks on. So if you look at the two images on top of each other, there are some cases where it could be a little bit off. So to fix that, you have to choose more points so that it has more to work with. And there's another way to do it where it's more automatic, where the computer would analyze the pictures. So in this example, it's again the same sample, but it's rotated. And so how this works is it is converted into an 8-bit black and white image and then scanned for the darkest points. So to do that, in this picture, they're called maxima. And in this picture, it found 1,700 about. And I don't know if you can see them, but those are all of the points. So this would obviously be more accurate than the manual. And in the other image, there's 1,600. And then when they're aligned, it goes like this. So the two images, it was rotated so that it was matching the same orientation. So then to save them, they can be exported as TIFF files so that you can save the layers. And it preserves all the metadata, which would be from the microscope that you would want to know, like the scale, how many nanometers. And maybe in the future, if this becomes bigger, you would need to find a way to store all of the images. Basically, overall, this project benefits a lot of people with imaging and microscopy. So that's how it would be helpful at the lab. And this is some acknowledgments that I have, the research group that I was with. And thank you for listening.
Hi, I'm Trisha Dada. I attend Princeton University, and today I'm going to be talking to you about my work titled Using SVM for User Profiling for Autonomous Smartphone Authentication. It's based on research that I did this summer at Applied Communication Sciences. So first, a short outline of what I'm going to be talking to you about. I'll briefly describe our motivation and objectives for this project, then I'll talk to you about the data collection and decision-making app that we created for this project. Then I'll describe to you the data set that we use for our research. And the way that we decided to go about our research was to use machine learning techniques, which you've heard a lot about today. And in order to do that, we had to construct and select features for these techniques. Then we need to train on these techniques and then test on them, and I'll talk to you about that as well as the analysis of that testing, and then I'll talk to you about future work. So the motivation for this project is that according to a 2013 study, 5.6 million smartphone users have experienced undesirable behavior on their smartphones. What does undesirable behavior mean? Well, it's basically anything that wasn't authorized by the user, so by the owner of the phone. So some things such as sending unauthorized text messages or accessing accounts without owner permission. And other surveys also show that people aren't protecting their phones with passcodes. So they're skipping this very simple way of protecting their phones. But since there clearly is a threat, we have to find some other way of protecting these phones if people don't want to use passcodes, and that's the goal of our project. So the goals, just to elaborate a little bit more, are to distinguish between legitimate behavior, so legitimate behavior of the actual owner of the phone, as well as behavior of people who don't own the phone. And then we want to secure the smartphones once we realize that someone who isn't the owner of the phone is using the phone. And that this way, we'll reliably avoid legitimate owners having to enter their passcode every time they want to use their phone. So how are we going to do this? So we want to learn about the legitimate user's behavior. And once we do that, we also want to make sure that we're learning new habits. So if they develop new habits on their phone, we recognize those as legitimate. And then we want to develop mechanisms to detect when people who are not the legitimate owners of the phone begin using the phone. So the first thing that we did in our process was to create an app to collect data from the phone, because that's how we wanted to differentiate between the owner of the phone, people who weren't the owner of the phone. And we did this we created an Android app using a Samsung S4. Its primary function was to collect and store data, and it collected a variety of data from Wi-Fi access point information to GPS information to simple sensor readings. And then we implemented simple training mechanisms and simple decision-making mechanisms. So for the training mechanisms, we could record known GPS locations and known Wi-Fi access points. And then for the decision-making mechanisms, once the user had stepped outside a radius of known GPS locations or encountered several new Wi-Fi access points, then we could lock the phone, because this would be identified as illegitimate behavior. And then our app could also learn, so if the user was then able to unlock the phone, it could learn these new locations or Wi-Fi access points as legitimate locations or Wi-Fi access points. So while we wanted to use our own app to collect data because of timing restrictions and device restrictions, we couldn't use our own app, so we decided to use public data sets. And we actually used two public data sets. The first one was from Glasgow Caledonian University in the UK. And it's a relatively small data set. It contained data from 4 users over the course of 3 weeks. And it had a lot of the same information that our app actually collected, so Wi-Fi information, GPS information, etc. And you can see some of the preliminary analysis that we did in that graph there. Those are app usage statistics for 4 pretty common apps, and you'll see that for each of the 4 users, the statistics vary quite widely, so that gives an idea that it was a pretty good idea to use app usage statistics to differentiate between users. Because there are only 4 users in this data set, and it's only over the course of 3 weeks, it wasn't quite big enough to suit our needs. So then we turned to data from Rice University, and this data set had data from 34 users collected over the course of the year. And again, it had data on app usage, Wi-Fi information, GPS information, etc. So the way that we decided to go about differentiating users is using supervised machine learning. And the way that this works is you feed in a set of data, and every data point in a set of data is either labeled as +1 or -1. So in our case, it would be every data point in the data is labeled as either belonging to the actual owner of the phone or belonging to someone else. And that's indicated by those red and green dots up there. And then what the machine learning techniques will do is they'll generate a function that you can use on new data points, and you can pass those new data points through the function, and you'll get an answer whether or not this data point belongs to the actual owner of the phone or someone else. So in order to use these machine learning techniques, we have to create the data to feed into them. So we looked at app usage statistics, as you remember from that other slide from the GCU data, app usage statistics just from looking at a graph seem to be a pretty good indicator of user habits, so that's why we decided to look at them. And we decided to aggregate the data to reflect both temporal variation as well as volume of use. So the way that we did that is we divided each day into 3 8-hour epochs, and then we counted the average number of seconds that each app was in use during the epochs. The only problem was we had around 2,300 apps used by all 34 users, and so that gave us around 6,900 features, and we really wanted to reduce the number of features for several reasons. One is if you have too many features, that makes the running time for finding the function that can determine whether your data points belong to the owner or non-owner. That function takes a really long time if you have too many features. And then another thing is not all of the apps were really useful, because some of us, we download an app, we use it once, and then we never use it ever again. So we didn't really want all the extra noise in our function. So the solution to this, which is really the new contribution of this research, is to use mutual information. And mutual information calculates the probability densities of different features to figure out which features are best suited to differentiate between different users. So kind of to give an example, say everyone is using Facebook all the time. Well, it's a pretty, I mean, that's something that we use a lot, but it's not the best way to differentiate between different users. We want something where the habits differ from user to user. And that's what mutual information gives us. So if you look at those two graphs over there, they'll show you the 100, I think, highest mutual information values for those total 6,900 features. And they're actually, the two graphs represent the same information, it's just that second graph doesn't have that highest value, just to give you a better perspective of the rest of the values. So the next thing we did was we actually trained using our features, and we decided to use SVM, which is support vector machines, which is one of the most widely used supervised machine learning algorithms. And I'm just going to talk about some nomenclature just specifically for this project real quick. So false positives, when we say false positive, we mean the owner being identified as a non-owner, and then a false negative would be the non-owner being identified as an owner. And obviously a false negative here is a lot more dangerous because it would compromise the security of the phone. So to implement our SVM training, we use the library libSVM, and there are two types of SVM training. There's one-class SVM and two-class SVM. So one-class SVM is a clustering method, which you heard about earlier today. And this would seem like the way to go, because the way it works is you just feed in some data and you don't label it plus one or minus one, and the clustering techniques will try to find a function that fits. But it actually didn't work that well for several reasons. One is the parameters that you have to choose, it's very hard to choose them correctly and time-consuming, and it's not exactly scientific. And then when we got parameters that seemed like they were the best that they could be, we ended up getting very high false negative rates, which is, again, really bad, because if we're identifying people who aren't the owner of the phone as the owner of the phone, that really compromises the security of the phone, and that's not what we want to do at all. So the other type of SVM is two-class SVM, which is the one that I showed in the slide earlier, where every data point that you feed in is either classified as plus one or minus one. And so when we did this, we actually got pretty good results, so this is the way that we decided to go. And we created training data sets for each of the individual 34 users, and each training data set had half of the data from the user that we're looking at, and half of the data was a collection of data from the other 33 users. And we used a grid search to find the best values of the two parameters that you choose with two-class SVM. And grid search is basically, you have a set of values, a range of values for one of the parameters, you have a range of values for the other one, and you just test all possible pairs and combinations. Whichever one is the best one, that's the pair that you use. And we used an RBF function because it's best suited for our purposes. So then we had to test our functions that we created using the machine learning techniques. And we created test data from all the data that we had used for training. And you can see our results there in case you can't read it. The blue is the accuracy rate overall. The orange is the false positive rate, and the gray is the false negative rate. And you notice that our average accuracy rate was around 85%, which is pretty good. Our false negative rate is very low, which is very important because, again, we don't want to identify non-owners as the owner of the phone, because that would be very bad for security. We do have some very high false positive rates, I'll explain a little bit more later why that may be. But those aren't really dangerous, because all that would mean is if you're identifying the actual owner of the phone as someone who's not the owner of the phone, it would just mean they would have to enter their passcode, which isn't the worst thing in the world. So just a brief summary. Preliminary tests indicate high success rates in determining when someone other than the owner of the phone is using the phone. And we do have a high false positive rate. Sometimes that would really compromise the security of the phone in real life. And future work would be, so for the mutual information computations, we only really did it in respect to user one, which could explain some of the high false positive rates. So in future, we want to do these computations with respect to all users. And if you were to implement this in an app, we would actually have to do that, so that's pretty simple. And we'd also want to look at information other than just app usage statistics, so Wi-Fi information, GPS information, and then aggregate all this information to hopefully form a more comprehensive model of user behavior. And then we'd also hope to have enough time in the future to conduct this analysis on data that we actually recorded with our app. Thank you. Are there any questions?